morning, especially anyone who's driving home. That might help for the roads, the nerves, settle the nerves from the drive-in. So if you feel like you'd like to, just come on up and get a smudge, and then we'll get the opening things along the way. So.
Double, we'll get started.
Good morning, everyone. Waliasipuok. Waldasi Begazano, Giskuk. I'm glad to see so many people here today, especially braving the weather. Shows the passion a lot of people in the room have about treaty education. We're going to get underway soon, but first I'd like to ask Sister Dorothy Moore to come up and give us an opening prayer. Thank you, Sister, for your opening prayer. And thank you, Jeff Ward, for coming in to do a smudge for us to get this day started with positive energy and with spirituality. Just for some housekeeping notes before we get started, there's the bathrooms are just out here to the left. We have some muffins there. We'll be having coffee and tea throughout the day. We'll have lunch at 12 o'clock. And without further ado, I'd like to just thank everyone for being here today. It's an important discussion that we have today and an important steps moving forward that we have and moving forward with the treaty education. I'd like to call up Chief Leroy Denny, who's the lead on education for the Assembly of Nova Scotia Chiefs. He's also the chair of Mi'kmaq Gnamadnoi, a former student of Mi'kmaq studies at Cape Breton University, as well as a graduate with a BED from St. FX. Leroy has been a teacher. He has worked with Mi'kmaq curriculum as well. He's now the chief of the largest Mi'kmaq community in Nova Scotia. And so, without further ado, Sawmow Chief Leroy Denny.
Good morning. Hello, Tio. Beautiful day, beautiful snowy day. Thank you for joining us today. This is a very important and very exciting, actually, very exciting day to in the history of Mi'kma'ki, and especially in education. And I guess I just want to thank the Jaime and our sponsors and our team that they put together this very important event. As a former student in Mi'kmaq studies, as a former teacher of Mi'kmaq studies, and as chief, it is an honor to be here today to share with you the importance of Mi'kmaq treaty education. There are far too many people today we believe that treaties are thing of the past, and it has no modern day significance. So we are here today to change that. Our Mi'kmaq peace and friendship treaties are the foundation for how we as Mi'kmaq and settlers, both old and new, have to come from what we know as Nova Scotia. It is only through the recognition of the treaty relationship that we have been able to coexist the generations of our ancestral Mi'kmaq lands, and it is only through education about our treaty relationship that we can create mutual understanding of all Nova Scotians in future. I was very happy to see how many of our leaders are still passionate about our treaties when we mentioned this workshop to the chiefs of Nova Scotia. Also to the Grand Council members, Andre and the Grand Chief, Ed Siniboy. I'm also very pleased to hear that treaty education will be a priority for the provincial education system. That's very huge. In December, I had an opportunity to sit down with the Minister of Education, Karen Casey, and talk with Premier McNeill, and I believe that we can work together to ensure that Mi'kmaq are better represented within the public school system. I am hopeful that we can work together, hear recommendations of our elders, our Grand Council members, our educators, and our youth in moving forward on treaty education throughout the province. Our history of Mi'kmaq must be told from our Grand Chief Member to baptism 400 years ago, to the residential school's legacy, and about Donald Marshall Jr.'s struggle for justice. This is just some of the legacy of our Mi'kmaq ancestors. It must be represented within Nova Scotia school systems. The chiefs and I look forward to hearing your hopes, dreams, and recommendations on this important subject. And before I end, we were just in Toronto a few days ago with Eleanor and some people from MK and dinner with, actually wasn't a dinner, it was a session with Paul Martin on Aboriginal education. And I remember one of the chiefs there, I forget his name, the Grand Chief there, he said, raise your hand if you're a treaty person. And there were a lot of non-natives in the room. So mostly Aboriginal people raised their hands. But he said that everybody should raise their hand. We're all treaty people, as you says here, including people in Nova Scotia, Mi'kmaq and non-Mi'kmaq, because of the treaties. They were both signed by the Crown and the Mi'kmaq. So by concluding, I want to thank our sponsors, Mi'kmaq and Amadnoi, Tripartite Forum, St. Effects University. I think I've seen Jeff's. Jeff is here? Is Jeff here? Oh, there's Jeff. Jeff's my former professor at St. Effects. CBU as well, Nova Scotia Office of Aboriginal Affairs, and Nova Scotia Department of Education. And I'm really proud of our sponsors who to make sure this event happened today. I hope you guys have an awesome and awesome 2 days.
I'd like to now call up Grand Captain of the Mi'kmaq Grand Council, Andrew Denny. Andre Denny, as most of us know him, is also a graduate of Cape Breton University under the Mi'kmaq Studies program, and he is one of the chairs of the Tripartite Forum as well. Andre?
Gwe, hulal yotel bejida yok, gei du medu ikiskegak, jiji wak wan jibat skudum in gowi na delamuk na, kadu uskud mukinu na sega kado andal gina muksig na. I just want to welcome everybody from near and far. I know it's a terrible day to travel. I know the whiteouts coming up this morning in East Bay, it wasn't it was really dangerous, so I'm really glad that school was cancelled today for the kids back home. Anyway, I would like to welcome everyone here today and thank you for taking your time, over the next 2 days to be part of this important discussion and strategy of treaty education. Mi'kmaq treaty education is not just about the written text. You know, it is what was agreed by our ancestors more than 250 years ago. But it is much more than that. How our ancestors attempted to create harmony within our ancestral lands? The courts have stated that the real treaties are Indian negotiations, thus we must focus on what the Mi'kmaq who signed these treaties understood and what was their vision. Treaty education is about the relationship between the Mi'kmaq and the Crown and the settlers, who had to figure out how to coexist, how to share, how to learn, and how to be friends. Peace and friendship are the focus of the Mi'kmaq treaties. However, unlike many other treaties, they retained our way of life, our lands, our gifts, and our resources. Mutual understanding is important. For decades, Mi'kmaq have learned about Canadians, about the British, and the new settlers in the school system. For years, we have learned in formal schools of a history that had little or no mention of Mi'kmaq people. When I was in high school, I remember seeing only 3 sentences about the Mi'kmaq. I've talked about that numerously, but the proud history that my father and his father had passed down only included the fact that we were uncivilized, we were savages, and we were warlike. Those are the very first things I remember in high school when we talked about Mi'kmaq. And knowing who I was, knowing who my father was, I immediately asked him when I went home. Of course, the poor Mr. Johnson at the time wanted him to come and go to our history class that time, and when I was only in grade 10. We never got to do it, but I guess it started there when we look at what our children have been taught over the years. Anyway, we have come a long way since the Constitution entrenched our treaty rights in 1982. The court began the process of recognition of our treaties in 1986 in the Simon case. However, we have a long way to go in understanding the treaties and, of course, treaty implementation. Today, we begin the journey towards improving what we know about the Mi'kmaq and their treaties. The Mi'kmaq Grand Council have asked for years, if not decades, for treaty education and treaty implementation. Today we begin the journey towards improving what we know about the Mi'kmaq people and our treaties. The Mi'kmaq Grand Council, have tried to make it a priority for our education system. Treaty education has to be prioritized and improved. So in that, I am proud to take this journey with you in our discussion over the next 2 days and beyond to ensure our treaty education and our shared relationship is told to all of our children in not only Mi'kmaq, but Nova Scotia. We need to educate our Mi'kmaq communities as well as public schools from Bedeck, Halifax, all the way down to Yarmouth. We also need to educate the new immigrants who come to this beautiful land so that they understand the contributions of the Mi'kmaq and the importance of treaty relationship. Only through education can we reach understanding from the many people who call Nova Scotia their home. In this, I would like to thank the Tripartite Forum Education Committee for making treaty education a priority. I would especially like to thank the subcommittee who made this workshop possible today. And these are Jaime Batiste, Eleanor Bernard, John Jerome Paul, Wyde White, Anne Denny, Justine Paul, for their work these past several weeks. I look forward to the presentations, and I am also filled with hope of what we can accomplish by working together in the future. This is just a first step, but it's important that when we talk to the chiefs, they want all the political leaders in these discussions. And I say political leaders, after every election, we may have new political leaders, but what's so important is the fact that this has to be in the school system of Nova Scotia, where all Nova Scotians, all the kids in the Maritimes and Mi'kmaq territory learn about our treaties. They will be the future leaders. We always talk about our children as the future leaders. Well, Nova Scotia has future leaders too, and they need to learn about the Mi'kmaq, about their allies. about their allies in the school system. Why do they have alliances? But it's important that it was only our neighbors from East Bay or Winnacketty or Christmas Island, or you know, it depends on what community you lived in, that knew about the Mi'kmaq, knew about the treaties, because knew of how we lived. So it's important that we are here today to not be afraid of each other. The past is the past, you know. But reconciliation is talking about the past, what has happened, and moving forward to make a better society, not only for Nova Scotia, but for Canada. Yeah.
I would like to call up next one of our presenters today. Her name is Brenda Ann Hanicue. She is the Director of Educational Program, Office of the Treaty Commissioner. And I just want to give a little background bio on Brenda. Brenda Hanicue is a member of the Beardies and Okamasis First Nation. She received her early education at Marcellin and later at Prince Albert Collegiate Institute. She obtained her Bachelor of Education from University of Regina and has also studied at the University of Saskatchewan and the University of Manitoba. As a classroom teacher, she has taught students from kindergarten to university. Brenda has focused on improving the education system in First Nations communities by being actively involved in youth sports and education. The majority of her career has been as a director of education for the Beardie and Okamasis First Nation, the Saskatoon Tribal Council, and the Atikokau First Nation. Growing up as the daughter of Frida Hanicue, one of Canada's leading Aboriginal scholars, set the stage for Brenda to become a writer, a translator, and an editor with several publications. She has co-translated three of Thompson Highway's children's book into Cree and has compiled two anthologies, Native Voices, the Issues Collection, and Voices of First Nations People, both of which are used to complement high school language arts curricula. She also worked as part of the team that wrote the Saskatchewan Core Cree 10, 20, 30 curriculum. A strong advocate for the advancement of First Nations youth and education, Brenda has been an active participant on a number of boards and committees at the local, provincial, and national level. I'd like to take this time now to call up Brenda Hanicue. Thank you.
Thank you, Jaime, and good morning to you all.
Just push this back a little bit for you so it isn't shoved in your face.
I'm just trying to figure out how I can do this here.
Maybe. Let's push this in.
How is that? How are you doing? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? I think so.
Okay.
And the sun shines. Good morning. Thank you, Jaime. And it's great to be in Nova Scotia. It's been many, many years, as I was telling Dr. Henderson, that I was here maybe about 20 years ago. And have this my first time back since, so lovely, lovely, beautiful. But I woke up this morning, looked out the window, and I thought, darn, I landed back in Saskatchewan with all the snow and the blizzard conditions. Greetings to Grand Captain Denny, Chief Denny, John Jerome, an acquaintance from many, many years ago at the National Table on Education, Doctors Sagig and Marie, and Darren Gu. These are the faces that I recognize around the table, and hopefully I can have a chat with a few more of you over the course of the next couple of days. Have been reading and following Member 2 and the Nova Scotia Mi'kmaq Education for a number of years, and I think congratulations are in order on the strides that the Mi'kmaq have taken in moving forward in treaty education. We in Saskatchewan, I'm with the Office of the Treaty Commissioner, and I work as the Director of Educational Programming. So I'm going to have an overview of what we do at our office and how we came to be where we are at now, 25 years after the Office of the Treaty Commissioner was established. I also have some books that we can view, and then I'll leave them with Jaime, and whoever's paying attention can probably win them in the end. They're not my books. They're the Office of the Treaty Commissioner, and they're some of the resource material that we have either developed or we've taken on as resources for the teachers in the school. I also have a video collection that we will donate to the school system here. It's on the treaties in Saskatchewan, the treaty relationships. So, two other handouts here. I have the one is our quarterly newsletter from the Office of the Treaty Commission, just an overview of what we've been up to in the last quarter. And the second piece is the timeline, First Nations timeline from perspective from in Saskatchewan. And it basically gives the history of Saskatchewan First Nations people throughout time. Things that, like Grand Chief said, we've never learned in the school systems. It's from things that are from our oral traditions or some people, things that have been neglected to be taught within our public education systems, things that have been neglected to be included in our curriculum or resources. So, okay. Let's see if we can do this. Whoops. Went to sleep on this boat. There we go. This slide is actually a picture of our old and retired website. I put it up here for a couple of reasons. First, the pictures here I like because it of the veterans, the elders, the chiefs, the flags, and the treaty medal. These all speak treaty. They're visuals about treaty. One of the chiefs said, most people in Canada think that treaty people are First Nations. But in reality, if you live in this land, we call Canada, if you're a Canadian citizen, you're a treaty person. It's amazing how many people find that hard to accept, to understand that if you are Canadian, you are a treaty person. So people need to understand throughout this land that the land that we enjoy today, Canada, it was built on treaties from coast to coast, from the relationships between the newcomers and First Nations people. They need to understand that a treaty is a promise. When you explain what a promise is to a kindergarten child, how do you explain what a treaty is? Take it to the promise. A promise is a promise. I think Robert Munch has a book called A Promise is a Promise. Perfect for relating to the treaties. They agreed to something. First Nations people agreed to share the land with the newcomers. First Nations people did not sell the land. That's not First Nations concept of land is not owning, ownership. It is, it was sharing. So the next slide is our real website. As you can see, we are all treaty people. That's the tagline of the Office of the Treaty Commissioner, and we invite people from across Canada to use that. Whether you're a First Nations entity, a government agency, a business in the community, a group, the Kinsmen Club, the Rotary Club, we are all treaty people. So you'll see this throughout the presentation, throughout all of our publications, we are all treaty people. We have this piece is the download of all of our newsletters. This one I will go more into. This is the educational piece of it, and with the tags onto it. And this is our video collection. So there's more to the Office of the Treaty Commissioner than education, believe it or not. We have the Treaty Commissioner is George Lafond, but the office itself is established between the Federation of Saskatchewan Indian Nations, the federal government, and the province as an observer. And they discuss treaty issues. Education resources, if you went on this website, otc.ca, by the way, is the website. It's real simple, otc.ca. We have the Statement of Treaty Issues, Teacher Wiki Space. I'll explain a little more about these later on. The workshops for educators, the teacher workshops, the publications that support treaty education, the Speakers Bureau, and the Treaty Kit. This one is relatively new to the Office of the Treaty Commissioner in the last few years. It is the Treaty Promise to a Continued Livelihood. What is a continued livelihood when you're thinking of treaties? It's making a living. The right to make a living. When our forefathers sat down and negotiated treaties, what did they want? They did not want to be dependent on anyone for a living. They wanted to continue their making a living, being independent. So that would have been hunting, fishing, trapping, gathering. Treaty promises. This section also delves into resource revenue sharing, which is a bit of a scary issue for the current day government. So that Miltitusis is the one that heads up the treaty promises to a continued livelihood piece of the Office of the Treaty Commissioner. So what is OTC? The OTC, again, as I said earlier, is the agreement between the federal government and the Federation of Saskatchewan Indian Nations, which is the 74 bands of Saskatchewan, and with the province there as an observer. Initially, it was established because of the treaty land entitlement bands. There was many bands in Saskatchewan who lost some of their reserve land through one way or another. They ended up losing land, or they were never given the proper amount of land. In any case, they did not have the entitlement land that they were promised in the treaty. So the Office of the Treaty Commissioner was established to look at treaty land entitlement, which resulted in the TLE agreement, Treaty Land Entitlement Agreement Framework, for 28 of the bands in Saskatchewan who had shortfall acres in land. So that's why initially the Office of the Treaty Commissioner was established. Secondly, it was to promote good relations. Promoting through and only through education. I feel like I'm repeating the chief's words here when I was listening to him, and he was saying, and I hear it often, I hear it from our elders, I hear it from our teachers, from our educators. Only through education can we make people understand treaties. The relationship that we are all treaty people. So the Office of the Treaty Commissioner facilitates discussions between the Federation of Saskatchewan Indian Nations, or member bands, and Canada on treaty issues, such as education, health, livelihood, and reconciliation. Reconciliation as it pertains to residential schools, land acquisitions, and treaty adhesions. Recently, one of the bands in central Saskatchewan signed an historic treaty adhesion, Montreal Lake First Nation, signed in October. So that was also provides that mechanism to those parties to address issues, to explore modern implementation concerns, and resolve differences. So the treaty, just very quickly, the treaty commissioners, this is important, simply because of who these people are. Cliff Wright was the very first treaty commissioner. He was actually the mayor of the city of Saskatoon, and then was approached because he was integral, I guess, in the discussions between the treaty land entitlement chiefs and the province and the city of Saskatoon, because the intent was to establish an urban reserve within the city of Saskatoon. So Cliff Wright was the mayor at the time of the TLE, and he became the first treaty commissioner since Alexander Morris, of course. And then Judge David Arnott was a provincial court, Queen's Bench Court judge. He had always had a keen interest in treaty issues. So he penned the book, Statement of Treaty Issues, Treaties as a Bridge to the Future. So a bridge, the treaties being in the past, the treaties being here, and the treaties being in the future. The next treaty commissioner was the Honorable Bill McKnight. He was a member of Parliament and the Minister of Indian Affairs before he came to be the treaty commissioner. And then the current treaty commissioner is George Lafond. George Lafond is from the Muskegon Cree Nation. He's the first treaty commissioner ever to be of First Nations treaty ancestry. His mother was one of the first female chiefs in Saskatchewan as well. So moving on to this, how the treaty education in Saskatchewan was kick-started province-wide, I guess, was the throne speech statement by Premier Bradwell in 2007. He said that it would become mandatory for all schools to teach treaties in every subject, in every grade. And here, this next slide is the actual statement. And I know all of you can read, but this one is the important one. This is the cornerstone of what treaty education, how it came about in Saskatchewan. There must be an appreciation in the minds of the general public that treaties are living, breathing documents that continue to bind us to promises made generations ago. This is why my government is committed to making mandatory instruction in history and content of the treaties in the K-12 curriculum, said by Premier Bradwell in the throne speech of 2007. So, when this statement was made, it made big news. It was in the throne speech. The Saskatchewan Teachers Federation that represents the teachers, the provincial systems, quickly responded, saying that you can't do that. How can you do that to us? We have never been taught about treaties. We don't know anything about treaties. How can we teach them? We don't have the resources. We don't have the training. Our teacher education, when we were training to be teachers, no one made mention of treaties. The only time we ever heard anything about it was if we took an elective Native Studies class. And most people didn't. So there was a huge uproar from the Saskatchewan Teachers Federation, the Teachers Union of Saskatchewan. And so they're saying, we don't have the training, we don't have the curriculum, we don't have the resources to implement what the Premier said would happen in the throne speech. So what to do? Luckily, the Office of the Treaty Commissioner at the time, had close connections with a fellow named Ken Horseman. Ken was the Deputy Minister of Education with the provincial government at the time, and he was very much a treaty advocate. So the ministry then turned to the Office of the Treaty Commissioner for help. They said, we need to find some solutions. How are we going to do this? How are we going to implement treaties, teaching treaties in the classroom through in every grade, let alone every subject? So this was the beginning of the goal to incorporate that into treaties into the curriculum. So the landscape of Saskatchewan education, just a very quick snapshot, the provincial schools, there are 755 schools. Independent schools are like the Montessori schools and the private schools, there's 60 of them. First Nations schools, 85, and then the three main universities, and then the technical institutions, and that. So the numbers are huge. So an outline of the OTC, Office of Treaty Commissioner Education, is number one, teaching treaties in the classroom, materials, treaty resource renewal, public education, the Speakers Bureau, and teacher workshops. So that's what we're going to be talking about. I just wanted to give you a quick overview of how we came to be where we're at now. So this is the treaty kit. Now the treaty kit, the box on the side is, it's a, like a banker's box, but it's a nice one. Every school in Saskatchewan has a minimum of one treaty kit. So what's a treaty kit? The every First Nations school, every public school, Catholic school, the French schools, and the private schools, they all have a minimum of one treaty kit. And there's 24 pieces within that treaty kit, and some of the publications that I brought today are included in that treaty kit. It has the K-6 binder. One of the first things that was developed was what they call the K-6 binder. This is grade 6. You can see they're very colorful. Kindergarten has its own that looks just like this. The cover, beautifully matched. And these are teachings for grade 6 in the curriculum. Everyone has a folder with the map of the treaty boundaries within Saskatchewan in it. So the K-6 binder is about that thick. And then we have the 7-12 binder with, and that's the first teacher resource that was developed to assist the teachers in implementing the treaty education in the classroom. We have the TELS book. I'm getting ahead of myself. That's the one I just showed you. The TELS book, the Treaty Essential Learnings. I recall being at a education conference. It was a national education conference, and speaking to Judge David Arnott, who was the Treaty Commissioner at the time. And I was a director of education at the time, and we were just having this chat, and we're talking about treaty education and how do we forward, how do we get the word out, how do we disseminate the information. And so we started discussing what we call in Saskatchewan the common essential learnings. The provincial government has, and Maria knows more about this part than I do, but it's been a long time. We had common essential learnings where there were 6 components that every teacher needed to incorporate into their teaching. And it had nothing, absolutely nothing to do with treaties. It had had to do with the way children learned and how teachers presented their stuff in the classroom. But anyway, the framework for the common essential learnings, that can you imagine getting that information out to 805 schools? What they did was they chose some key people throughout the province. I think there was 24 people, and I happened to be one of them. We had to take training in the common essential learnings, this new catchphrase of the provincial government, to take training to go to be, it was a train the trainer program. So where these 24 people would then go back to their own school divisions or areas or tribal councils and teach their peers, the teachers, how to incorporate these common essential learnings. From that, we said, why do we not take that same concept and apply it to the treaty essential learnings? Why do we not have treaty essential learnings? So we got together with the people, the educators, and the directors of education, the elders in the communities, and what are the core learnings that we want our teachers to implement in the classroom? So these are the ones, the treaties, the treaty relationship, the historical context of treaties, First Nations and their and worldview, symbolism in treaty making, and contemporary treaty issues. So that brown book there, Timey, right on the bottom, so this short, sweet, not it's unintimidating for teachers to look at, and they can look at that in planning their unit plans, their lesson plans, their year-long plans, and take some direction from that. Some of the things that were important, I guess, was that are outlined in here is, number one, the treaties as a promise. 2, the treaty relationship, where it takes 2 parties to make that, to create that relationship, and the historical context, the how and the why of treaties. The how and the why of treaties, is that's the treaty relationship. The historical context, the worldview, outlining how generally First Nations people across this land had similar worldviews, in that there was one, Mamtum now, the creator. The creator as the supreme being, and then the animals, the plants, the animals, and all in the hierarchy of being things. Now, as compare that with the newcomer's worldview, where does man sit in that hierarchy of beings? There's God, and then man. That's like everybody has their own worldview, but the newcomers came across with that worldview, whereas the First Nations people, all the other beings in the hierarchy were above man. Man is at the bottom, and the way I was told was that if you take out any one of those elements of the hierarchy, man cannot survive. But if you take out man, they'll still all survive. They'll go on without man. So that kind of understanding that we wanted to portrayed to the people, it towards an understanding of how First Nations people think. Symbolism, what is symbolism? Symbolism is of treaties, the handshake, an agreement, a promise, friendship. The treaty medal, which we now have treaty medals that we have for teachers as a tangible, touching thing for them to teach treaties in the classroom so kids can touch that. The pipe, the meaning of the pipe in the treaties. What was the Ospogan, the pipe used for? The medal, the British flag. What was the role of the Northwest Mounted Police? The treaty suit. And what's the meaning of the handshake? Those are all concepts that we needed to bring forward in order to basic understandings towards the understanding of treaties. So we come to the treaty curriculum resource renewal. Right now the Office of the Treaty Commissioner is working with the Ministry of Education to better align treaty teachings, the treaty essential learnings, with the Saskatchewan curricula. They did not align side by side. It was very, very difficult for teachers to join the two to be able to implement treaty teachings. Prior to this curriculum renewal, the teachers had very little option on how to incorporate treaties into the classroom. Where they could, it was often personal choice of the teacher, an add-on maybe at the end of a unit or at the end of the school year or First Nations Day in the school. But more often than not, it wasn't being done, and it just simply wasn't. It was part of that, no fault to the teachers, again, because they didn't have the training, they didn't have the background, they didn't have the resources. And so the province needed that curriculum. So they approached us again to do the treaty curriculum resource renewal, which we're in right now in the final phase of developing that resource renewal. Pardon me. So teacher resource specific to grade level or non-existent. So the goal, I hope that's not my phone. Okay, why? The existing K-12 treaty resource need to be renewed because they did not align with the provincial renewed curriculum, and the alignment of the K-12 treaty resources to provincial includes the ministry subject area goals and outcomes document, and that is on the ministry website. I can get that to you, Jamie, if you have that. The outcomes and indicators of the provincial government. I can get that to you. So the development of it takes a great amount of time, a great amount of people, a great amount of resources to do it. So why do we do it? There's the why, where's the how? And this might be where we combine the provincial treaty indicators and outcomes with the Office of Treaty Commissioner K-12 treaty teachings. This and the K-12 binders. Curriculum renewal. The treaty curriculum renewal team oversee the project. Then the writers, the pilot teachers, the elders, the review process, the vetting process, all of those have to, it goes through all of those before. So this is the first time that it's been with a from a First Nations perspective. Dispelling myths and misconceptions. is a basic thing. We have, to do that, the Office of the Treaty Commissioner have, you can, these two are on our website, the CTV Treaty Message Minutes. CTV is province-wide, and we've developed 30 and 60-second vignettes that tell about treaty issues from a First Nations perspective. And they're all on our website. There's must be about 10 of them now. And they are aired throughout Saskatchewan on all the CTV networks. We have a newspaper insert that we try and do once a year, and it's about a 10-page insert, you know, those, it's like an info bullet and then a huge newsletter in Saskatoon Star, Phoenix, and the Regina Leader Post, the two major newspapers in Saskatchewan. And then the Saskatoon Airport display is simply a display depicting treaties in Saskatchewan, the five treaty areas. And so people in and out of Saskatoon by air will look at this, will see this treaty display. And it's the only one in Canada. And right now, while the Saskatoon Airport is being remodeled, it's been put to rest for a while. It's in storage, but it will be going up again once. So the Speakers Bureau, main purpose is to spread the word of treaty, to build better relationships, and to create and maintain harmony throughout Saskatchewan. The Speakers Bureau is made up of about 25 or more members, people that are articulate, people that are knowledgeable about treaties, people that can answer questions about treaties and about First Nations people. And they generally have a great deal of knowledge in various subject matter pertaining to First Nations people. They speak to groups from all over Saskatchewan and all kinds of groups that generally outside the education system. They speak to pre-service teachers, like the teacher education programs at the universities, the University of Saskatchewan, University of Regina, First Nations University, the provincial school divisions, tribal councils, Saskatchewan Research Council, the Mennonite Central Committee is a very good partner with us, the Superannuated Teachers Groups, and the RCMP training. The RCMP training, all RCMP in Canada go to Regina for training. They have their classroom training. We do two full days with the RCMP there in First Nations awareness and about treaties, so that they have that little inkling of knowledge at least before they hit the field. Superannuated teachers groups. I was approached by the president of Saskatchewan Superannuated Teachers, and they he said at their annual meeting, it came to the floor that their grandchildren were being taught about treaties in the classroom. And they didn't know anything. They didn't know how to respond to their grandchildren to help them with the trees. So they have asked for training. So recently, we've been doing training with the superannuated teachers. They're all retired teachers, but their interest is in assisting their grandchildren in the schools. And often, a lot of them also do subbing in the schools in different schools throughout the province, so it's good for them to know, and that it's more excellent that they recognize that need, that they need to know that stuff. So how do we build that capacity? Teaching treaties in the classroom, building capacity. Teacher workshops. We have four types of workshops. Simply day one, day two, day three, day four. Day one is the history of treaty making. It's a general overview of like treaties in a snapshot. Day two is teaching treaties in the classroom. This is specific more for actual practicing teachers or teachers that in training. And the day three and day four are kind of a combined. In order to take day three and four, you the prerequisite is day one and day two. The day three and four is at what we call the Treaty Catalyst Teacher Training, where these people have not, once they've completed the full 4 days, are now able to go out and deliver the day one and the day two workshops within their tribal councils or their schools or their peers or their school divisions. We had from April, last April to January, we had 41 workshops with an average of our minimum numbers to deliver training is 20 people. We've done training to as many as 175 in one group. So there, it's a wide range. The workshops have been delivered in mainly English, but some in French. We do have French facilitators, and in the Cree language, which Cree is, I guess, that's got to be my phone.
Time's up.
It's probably my alarm. No. We've trained 129 Catalyst teachers this year, so there's 129 extra trainers out there in Saskatchewan. And only the Office of the Treaty Commissioner does the day three and four, the Catalyst trainers. It's the Train the Trainer program. What's interesting and is very good is the universities are now really starting to come on board. The University of Regina have an elementary section and a secondary section. They have now made it mandatory for their teachers and training programs to have the 2 days of Office of the Treaty Commissioner training, the day one and day two. If their students do not attend those workshops, they do not get their degree. So we're still working on U of S, but we do have workshops at the University of Saskatchewan teacher education programs as well. But where it's not mandatory, you know, you get the people that are really in it for personal reason, for personal professional development, growth and development, I guess. We have trained like over 7,000 teachers, so it's quite a large number, but it's amazing that there's still people that need to have workshops. With every workshop, we have elders, a minimum of one elder in with the facilitator. The elders are integral in developing the workshop and the workshop materials and the workshop agendas. What's going to be delivered and what is the training going to entail? The Catalyst teachers that come out of the Train-a-Trainer program assist other teachers to teach treaties in the classroom. And they contribute to the development of classroom material that they submit to the Office of the Treaty Commissioner in lesson plans, in all kinds of teacher-made activities that end up in the Office of the Treaty Commissioner Teacher Wiki space. Talk a little bit more about that in a bit. This is the treaty part. Some members of the Treaty Learning Network. The Treaty Learning Network is made up of First Nations elders first and foremost. So this one, there are 1, 2, 3, 4. Four of our elders sitting in the front, and then The ones in the back are traditional knowledge keepers, and every one of those deliver workshops in the throughout the province. Are also of note, in Saskatchewan, we have 5 or 6 different distinct language groups. So our elders table is made up representing each one of those language groups as well. Our facilitators are both First Nations and non-First Nations, because we're all treaty people. And they represent the whole province. We try to get trained people throughout the province. So that's Treaty Learning Network. The elementary and secondary school supports is the Treaty Kit, in servicing the Catalyst teachers, and additional materials within the Teacher Wiki space like Art Smarts. The elementary school supports are the Treaty Learning Network, of course, the elders as teachers, the website, online messaging system, Facebook, and distance learning. We do have started doing some distance learning. And the next one is the Wiki space. This is what the teachers, they need a password to get in here. You have to take the day one and day two training. So there's at least 7,000 people out there that are eligible to get into the Teacher Wiki space. And it provides the Treaty Learning Network with teachers with lesson plans for all grades, all subjects. We continue to add into there with PowerPoint games, smart board activities, novel studies. And again, it's a password access. But there's all kinds of things that you can navigate into there.
Novel study, is that different studies or studies of books? Novels.
Novels. Okay. Yeah, novel studies. Novel, yeah, it can be taken 2 different ways. This slide looks different. This one is what we call the grade 7 survey. Province-wide, in all schools in the province, First Nations school and provincial schools, there was a survey that grade 7 had to fill out. It was simple, multiple choice, but what do they know, what do those students, what have they learned about treaties? Initially, it was distributed to create a benchmark. Where are we at? What do the kids know? What do grade 7 students know, or what do they not know about treaties? So then this was given at grade 4 and at grade 7. So this is the grade 7. But there was a number of questions. So it gave us really good indicators of kind of pockets of knowledge throughout the province once all that data had been analyzed and what the needs were. So it gave us an indication of where to concentrate efforts or what's missing. All kinds of different things could be read into this survey, but it was handy. And for some reason, what was never explained to us, last year the provincial government pulled this. I'm not sure, they never explained it to us, and we thought it was an absolute great report card as to how we were doing, how the teachers were doing, how the provincial education system was doing in teaching treaties. And so in the last 2 years it has not been there, and we're trying to resurrect it, to have it back into the classrooms. University of Saskatchewan, these are some of the initiatives that we've been involved in. They're really moving forward in Aboriginal awareness, the University of Saskatchewan more so than other universities. This year, the Aboriginal Students Centre annual student handbook actually has 14 pages about treaty education in it. And a lot of that is thanks to Jaime's sister, Annie. Annie was working there and promoting that treaties and teaching treaties at the university and how the Aboriginal Students Centre needed to play a role in this establishing good relations amongst the university. The student president is a First Nations person, second time that the student union has had a First Nations president. And the chancellor of the university is a Cree from the Palmnaker First Nation, Blaine Fable. So that's another first for the University of Saskatchewan. So the Gwenna Moss Centre is teaching treaties online blackboard training. The Gwenna Moss Research Centre is part of the University of Saskatchewan, and they have a online blackboard exercise for employees of not students of the university, where you go in and there's a number of modules that you take online, and when that's finished, you have a face-to-face presentation from a workshop facilitator. It's an Aboriginal awareness initiative. And then we have Aboriginal Achievement Week at U of S, which is growing every year. We have a traveling display that our staff go to different venues where there's large gathering of people, education conferences, all kinds of conferences, really, treaty days, schools, and not necessarily all education related either. Like Saskatoon Tourism, we have a display at their conference, and the upcoming National Congress on Rural Education is being held in Saskatoon, so that's another. We recently received the Canadian Race Relations Foundation Achievement Award for OTC. This pictured here in the middle is Susan Bowden, who is the curriculum writer for the Treaty Renewal Resource. So that was in November. This is the second time that the Office of the Treaty Commissioner has received the Achievement Award from the Canadian Race Relations Foundation, recognizing the office for promoting anti-racism and good relations and understanding amongst Canadians in general. How are we doing for time? Way over? Okay. So, we are all treaty people. This is how you can reach us. It's the easiest way is go to otc.ca on the internet. And questions. This picture is a powwow arbor at Muskeg Lake Cree Nation. And see, that's Saskatchewan. We do have trees there. And a couple of hills. Yeah. Questions?
Uh-huh. And I was wondering if what's the outcome? Are there the students in provincial schools, are they reaching outcomes?
Yes.
Percentage. Are you sort of asked?
Yeah, the percentage is a hard one, but having the mandatory education, treaty education in the schools has really helped. The Grade 7 survey that I mentioned was a really good tool to gauge that. And in the last couple of years, then we were able to gauge the growth from year to year, how students were learning treaty education. The percentage of teachers that teach it right now, I would say might be, I'm guessing about 60%. We don't have any hard figures or data on that, but I know they, every school in the province has a treaty kit. Every school has a minimum of one treaty kit. I actually had an order of 10 treaty kits a couple weeks ago from New Brunswick, your neighbors. Yeah. So, any other questions?
Before we go take any more questions, I just said, like, if you do have a question, just stand and ask your question. Also, within your packages, that Jeff Orr has on page 3 after the third tab, you'll see where you can put your thoughts into some of the key concepts to consider, the content, resources of interest mentioned, and this is all going to inform later on, because this, as we know, is not just to hear presentations. We're actually being looked upon to create the strategy moving forward on treaty education. So if you do have questions, and I'm sure we have plenty of time for questions, just stand up and ask a question, and that would help.
As you started your work here, while you're doing your curriculum outcomes and goals, I guess, strategies, when you're putting together the other resource guide, I heard you mention that you often had to go back and readjust because they weren't lining up, and you had to redo and renew all your stuff. I think that's something that's an ongoing process, but is it more acceptable by the departments when you're doing that? I guess that would give it validity, would it not?
I guess the need arose, or it was identified by the teachers in the classrooms, that hey, the provincial government had this Ministry of Education outcomes and indicators document that, and the Office of the Treaty Commissioner had this, but somehow they weren't lining up. They weren't lining up. So then we came to, we have a close relationship with the Department of Education or Ministry in Saskatchewan. So the discussion came up that we needed to work on this to make sure that those aligned the treaty outcomes and indicators with the goals of treaty education.
So which would carry more strength? Are you going to meet the Department of Education? Okay, because your students obviously need to carry this information.
Yes. I mentioned that we are in the final stages of that renewed curriculum that we're working on from kindergarten through to grade 9. I didn't bring any. I might have some on my computer. I'm sure I do. Some of the work that's being done and how that's being done, and in the form of charts for each grade, for each grade level, what are the treaty teachings and how do they match with the ministry outcomes and indicators?
Yeah, I heard you mention as you're starting out with the younger ones that you start off as, treaty is a promise. I remember that 20 years ago, we did the same thing in our schools with the smaller children.
Yeah.
And of course, they all know that a promise is really important, especially with our kids.
Something
so you just carry it on through
right.
your curriculum,
right.
developing it each year.
Yes, adding to the deeper concept or the meaning. There's another question over here.
I guess my question was actually quite similar. In terms of the alignment of your thing, did they look at the existing provincial curriculum and see where it would fit in, or did they say these are things that are missing? They're two different things. But I know in the provincial curriculum, there's a lot of talk, there's a lot of appreciation of different cultures and stuff. So they just try and find places within the provincial curriculum in order to place one of the objectives or one of the outcomes? Or did they say these are things that are missing from the provincial curriculum
right.
and that need to be brought into it?
Right.
And are they, yeah. I'm just wondering about the alignment myself as well.
Mm-hmm. Maybe during the break I can bring up one of those charts and we can look at it, and it might make it more clear on how that alignment lines up. What is your question again?
My question is, did they try and say that this is the provincial curriculum?
Yes.
These are the outcomes, and this is where they match up with the provincial curriculum? Or did they say these are things that match up, but these are things that are not currently in the curriculum that need to be in there?
Right.
Because you're talking about basically two different things.
Exactly. The existing ministry outcomes and indicators were an expectation to be taught in the classroom, and then but the treaty ed didn't fit. So basically, the teachers were trying to fit, square pegs into round holes. They just wouldn't fit. So therefore, the teachers were doing treaty education as add-ons, or where they could make them fit, into the curriculum or into the classroom activities. So it was very difficult for teachers. So as the ministry moves forward to the high school level now, the grade 10, 11, and 12, they are having a renewed curriculum, and this time we said, this time let's do this together so that we're not coming back and trying to fix the problem after. They seemed receptive to that.
Just before I move on, I think we're much, I know that we all know, many of us know each other in this room, but when you get up to ask a question, if you could just introduce yourself. I know everyone knows Eleanor Bernard, Executive Director of MK, and Darren Google, who's Education Director and member too. So, but if you have a question, please just get up and state your name and which organization you work with, and that would help us out a great deal. We have people at home as well who are watching this live, streaming through YouTube and through First Nation Help Desk. So if you could, I know we don't have a mic to go around, but just ensuring that we have some mics set up around the room for some of the vocals. So it's yourself and then.
My name is Janet Coy, and I'm with the Department of Education and Early Childhood Development, and I'm in the area of literacy. I am quite interested in, you said initially that teachers were fairly reticent because they wanted the resources and the curriculum and guidance and so forth. I'm wondering if there's been an impact in the change in teaching practices based on the learning that have come through the treaty education, in the sense of the teaching practices being less Eurocentric, more inclusive of understandings of First Nations
people. Yes, there has been. There's some interesting things that go on, I guess, in Saskatchewan. And for instance, we had the Office of the Treaty Commissioner put up a display at Folk Fest, which is kind of a popular festival that celebrates all different cultures, and each of those cultures have their own kind of pavilion or display. And there was 34 different venues throughout the city, and we had the Office of the Treaty. We had actually 17,000 people come and visit over a course of 3 days, and there's like a steady flow. And we had developed that yellow sheet there. This just as a general information for people that would, we initially developed it for just so that people would have a snapshot of the timeline of First Nations people in Saskatchewan. But to answer your question, yes, there is definitely an uptake on the teachings, treaty teachings in the classroom. We now have kids from all cultures really teaching treaties themselves, little kids teaching other kids treaties, so it's interesting.
Well, I'm just taken back to when I was in high school and the fact that
Unladen.
Unladen, but the fact that I always thought back to the uncivilized part, when the Mi'kmaq were uncivilized, that no one, our history of our traditional government and of how our people were.
Right.
And my question is just the fact that due to loss of language, through the residential school, so to speak, we've lost a lot of that focus, that taught those values that were in the language itself.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and how do we move forward as we view our treaties?
Mm-hmm.
Now, as we look at our treaties, I'm one of the lucky ones where my father's bedtime stories were the treaties from his father. But mm-hmm. not all of our people had that advantage.
That's
so
great.
As we move forward, looking at the elders and speaking with the elders, you know, mm-hmm. how do we really bring in the concept of what the treaties mean to us from perspective to others that think we are uncivilized?
Exactly. The Hollywood Indian. Yeah.
Marie Tease here. I just wanted to make a comment for the people who are at the ministry, especially also with teacher training. As part of the University of Saskatchewan admissions process into the College of Education,
yes.
we have a required question as part of the 5-question interview that is done online to do as part of the admission process. And one of the questions refers to each year it changes, but this year's question that people had to answer was, what does it mean to we are all treated people? And what is the significance of that? So in the last few days, I've been reading my 30 admission questions, or the admission applications of 30 people, and all of them had to answer this question. And we have a rubric that goes with the admission, with the questions, to say, you give 1 point for this, -3 points for that, 2 points, 3 points, mm-hmm. 4 point for that. And so we were given a rubric of how they should answer it. So the other thing is, for the students to come into the teachers to come into the training, teacher training, they have to take a Native Studies course. It's a requirement, it's a mandatory course that they take. Used to be 6 credit units, but then now it's a 3-credit unit course that's directed to teachers. So there's a couple places where it is to try to foster more awareness of the teacher mm-hmm. Training mm-hmm. aspects of it. Mm-hmm. Although I have to admit that even within our college, that our faculty are not fully on board as to understanding what they are about. However, the Wetamos Learning Center, combined with a small group of us, put together the Indigenous Voices program for a period of 3 years as a part of the provost funds
yes.
to achieve that. So part of it was a stimulus from within of Indigenous faculty mm-hmm. who pressed for it, got it, got the money, and then it's kept on going. While at the same time we do other things like conferences and workshops in the college to keep on training both the teachers and also our prospective teachers
mm-hmm.
as well as those who are the staff that are in the college as well as in the University of Orange.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Marie.
John Jerome Paul with Mi'kmaq Nemadna, looking into the cameras so people can see. All of you just saw the back here. Anyway, there's a word used in the coming from the premier at that time, which was the notion of mandatory. That is mandatory that everybody get this education. How much impact do you feel that has had in, because remember, at some point, many of us have seen chapter one in all the books where we mentioned, didn't they forget about us? And also that we've been part of initiatives that said, yeah, move this along. And I always remember, and sister, you were on the with the Department of Education that time. That was about 95. We sent out a letter. We had, you know, asking principals, can you bring in more content? They always came back and said, well, we don't have any students in our system. We don't We can't cater to a few. If we have enough, then we'll respond. Like, and they always taught the education was for us.
Yeah.
And it's not. They're the audience. Yes. And you're back on the notion of mandatory, as they've made it.
Mandatory, and we are all treated people. Yes.
But they have to take it.
Yes, we have to take it. Mandatory treaty education in Saskatchewan is taking hold. Of course, there were resistors. Well, we don't have any First Nations around our territory, some would, people would say, so we don't need to teach it. Well, they totally missed the concept. So that's what some of the grade 7 survey told us, that we had pockets within the province that there was zero treaty education being taught, or minimal, or in or other places, really good treaty education where the students were responding appropriately. So.
Yes, Brenda, thank you very much for your presentation. Jeff Ort from St. Beck's University. I have a comment, I guess, on the catalyst teachers, and I guess there's a question in it, but I really am interested in what's going on in relation to the preparation and changing mindsets of principals. But around the catalyst teachers, can you tell us a little more about, do they actually work then coaching other teachers who may have less confidence to build their, is it more an in-school focus? And so that's the first part, and then the second part, I didn't hear anything about principals, and there is a saying that we use in leadership education that as goes the principal, so goes the school.
Right.
In other words, if the principal is not on board and does not value the change initiative, then it's less likely for it to happen. So can you tell us a little bit about those two things? Because they really get to the heart, to me, of that change at the school level, which is really, in my opinion, the hardest place for it to happen.
I always thought it was the janitor and the secretary. At least when I was working in the school, they were the real bosses. You're right, though. Correct. In the leadership of the school, the principals need to be on board. The school, the school boards, the school committees, and the principal, the leadership, the treaty catalyst teachers are throughout the province, and they many of them are teachers within a school. Some are principals, some are First Nations and Métis education consultants with school divisions, or education consultants with tribal councils. Some are directors of education. They kind of come from all walks of life within the education world. Yeah.
Terry Prosper from Buckland Cape. When I think about treaty education, I'm amazed at how much non-education there is out in the public, especially for people that are hunting in the woods, fishing along the shores, Mi'kmaq that are subject to racial slurs, and being given really bad attitude by other non-native fishermen, people that are hunting about are fishing before their season opens, or fishing in areas that are closed to the general public. And sometimes by the enforcers of the law, DFO guardians, natural resource people, sometimes they're uneducated about fishing.
Right. Yeah.
And also within our commercial fishing industry, where we do have a lot of flack about our treaty rights. I think fishing organizations, whether it's the salmon associations, the hunting associations, the people that are trained in the other institutions to enforce law, have to be educated on our rights, and I think there's going to be really willingness for local communities to learn about not only our treaties, but their obligation to our treaty also.
You're absolutely correct in that, and part of our training in the day one and two workshops is identifying those kinds of misconceptions, and how do teachers or catalyst teachers, how do they answer those, how they how do they address those? Because there are racial slurs out there, you know, about treaty and non-treaty, and especially in regards to hunting, fishing, trapping.
Jude Gerard from the Department of Education. I think one of the biggest barriers that we have for people here in the Maritimes realizing that everybody is treaty people is some of our successes ourselves when it comes to treaty cases that have gone to court.
Mm-hmm.
People are seeing that as us getting something as opposed to that equitable sharing of resources that are out there, which was supposed to be what was in the treaties in the first place. So I think that becomes one of the barriers, because the only time we ever hear about treaties is when they are in the papers when it comes to court decisions. We don't hear about the education pieces coming along with it. And I think that's one of the barriers that we have that might not be as much in Saskatchewan, because the treaties are more in the media. I mean, it was even up until the 1970s when Gordon Oakes signed on with the Nikitin to Treaty 4. Mm-hmm. So there are still people signing on to those historic treaties, which brings that into the public light. Here, it's a little bit of a different story, because the only time we ever hear about it is when there is a win, which there always is, Supreme Court. So it makes the rest of the province feel like it's something that's being taken away and they're getting something special, as opposed to getting that equitable share of the resources in the first place.
Right. Mm-hmm. Good point.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm just going back to the mandatory mm-hmm. stuff. Now, if it's mandatory for example, everybody to take that in the provincial school system. From a Mi'kmaq perspective, why is it not mandatory, for example, should it be mandatory for all of our students to try to take Mi'kmaq immersion, for example?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, that's something that's very important as we look at our language, and the heart of the treaties are our language.
Mm-hmm.
So, but before it can be mandatory, shouldn't it be recognized not only by the Mi'kmaq as the official language of the Mi'kmaq, mm-hmm. but by the federal and the provincial departments?
Mm-hmm.
That way they can get the resources to help that language.
Exactly. You're singing my song. As I mentioned, my mother was late Frida Henicu, and she spent her whole life revitalizing, preserving the Cree language and establishing the writing system and producing books for children and adults in university. So her whole life was exactly what you were saying, work on our own backyard first in regards to languages and establishing that that context for our children and their children.
My name is Sherry Conlon. I'm a student at the Cape Breton University. My major is in political sciences, and I'm very interested in what you have to say. And you had mentioned, like, you have these treaty kits in all the schools. The thing is, like, is this the treaty kits? What kind of activities do the students get out of those kits? Like, are mm-hmm. they there just, like, do they sit there, or are they actually mandatory for the education system mm-hmm. to say 1-2 out of the week, this mm-hmm. class has to take them out? And do you provide these kits to the different universities?
Mm. All the universities have these kits somewhere in the bowels of the university. Mostly the education centers, the libraries have them. They're everywhere. And as in regards to what's in them, mainly they are a teacher resource kit.
It's just because I talk a lot in my political classes, and mm-hmm. I talk about the different treaties, and I talk about, because the students don't even know who we are and what we do and mm-hmm. what our rights are. Even the professors are like, really? So I'm just wondering, like, would it be something that maybe us at Winnemong ECU can have a kit to take back with us? And
mm-hmm. They are available. The whole kit is available through the website, or the pieces of them. There's annotation within the website description of each of the books, so you can order them by pieces. Some of them are academic, others are for kindergarten.
How much?
130. The whole kit is $330.
My name is Stephen Augustine, Dean of Unamagi College. And yes, there is still an Unamagi College, despite all the problems we've been having in the last couple of years. But we're a growing concern, so. I just wanted to say also that I sang an honor song for your mother when she received the Order of Canada in
Ottawa.
Oh,
nice. You know. Good.
What I was wanted to ask was, like, we have treaty education, meaning education about treaties, but then there's also a treaty right to education. I mean, this is an interesting concept that Saugatch kind of dropped on our table once we were having a meeting. And our president has kind of, David Wheeler, has taken the initiative to push forward an idea to Canada and the provinces that education be a free, it should be free for all First Nations in Canada. And he went even further in saying, and perhaps we should be like Europe and have free education for everybody, for Canadians as well. But there's two aspects of it, of the question. I mean, it's not a question, it's a fact. And it's a Saugatch's fact, which I wanted to acknowledge as well, saying that education is a treaty right for all Aboriginals in Canada. And the other point I wanted to raise was that, are you doing any collaborative work with the Treaty Commission of Manitoba, with Jamie Wilson?
Yes.
Okay. So they're two interesting initiatives, and
yes,
I think, you know, like, we have a lot of expectations of our leaders and ourselves here in the Maritimes about our treaties, peace and friendship treaties. I mean, they were at one point not even recognized by the Canadian government.
That's right. Yes.
And they didn't see us as treaty people, and now we are all of a sudden. But I think there needs to be a very an important element about educating ourselves about our own treaties and the meaning of those treaties, as well as educating the mainstream society. And we have to do it in a very organized, stratified way. And you have brought to us a packaged way of dealing with treaty education. So I just want to commend you on coming here. Yeah. Thank you.
Brenda, my comment is not directed towards you, but more towards a message to the Department of Education here in Nova Scotia. And I guess the universities, I guess, should be a part of it as well. I don't think all of this should fall on the shoulders of the organizations such as Mi'kmaq and Anishinaabe. I think that it should be a shared responsibility. And I think that resources, financially and otherwise, should come from all areas, all departments. I don't think it should be just one organization or one department. Mi'kmaq and Anishinaabe are the only one that should be financially resourcing all of the things that
That's
are
right.
being talked about. I think, you know, the message should be carried back to the Department of Education and to the universities, Cambridge University, St. Effects. Everyone should be a part of it.
Carrie, you know, say.
Carrie Prosper, okay, again. Yeah, we're talking about treaty education, and Dooney mentioned was the responsibility of education. But we're also doing and talking about treaty implementation, exercising the treaty, combining education with actually exercising, going out on land and actually exercising the treaty. That's a very, very important thing, keeping treaties alive. And also our local governments are trying to implement the treaties, respect for the treaties, laws that go with the treaties. All of these combined efforts have to come together in a holistic look at developing our teams, educating them, exercising them, and keeping them, I guess, strong for future generations.
Yeah.
Ian Joseph, I'm with the Department of Education, and my question is just,
we are in Nova Scotia in a similar situation to where Saskatchewan was when the Premier made the announcement that the treaty should be mandatory. I'm just wondering if you have some suggestions for initial first steps and some things that happened in Saskatchewan that maybe we as a province should try to avoid when we move forward with our treaty education plan. I don't know if Jeff's got plans for that later on today or not, but I just thought I'd pose that question.
That's a loaded question. The do's and don'ts of treaty education. I guess when the previous to the Premier making that statement in 2007 and then again in 2008, there was a lot of strong relationship building between educators in the First Nations community and the leaders and the government people to establish that good working relationship first between the Ministry of Education and the First Nations people. So that's how it started in the first place, is who knows who kind of thing in Saskatchewan. And then once the Premier made that announcement again, as someone who's going to pay for this? You know, it's not cheap. You need to bring elders in. We have the elders are our primary guiding force throughout the whole process, from five language groups from hundreds and hundreds of miles away, from all the treaty areas of Saskatchewan. So it's monumental, like the provincial government in having the responsibility for education officer needs to step up to the plate, and where we are all treaty people, to implement that, to fund, to provide the resources for the development, for the gathering of people, to bring some, to create some really authentic materials, and establishing that vetting process for what is going to be written, what's going to be in the schools, who's going to review those. Are they the education and consultant experts in different subject specific, or the community members, the elders, the trainers? Good question.
We'll just take two more questions, elder in the back, and then Chief Ewer.
I do like this sort of to have a maybe a positive approach to recognizing the treaties that were there and the things and the rights that we have lost, rather than fighting after the fact that somebody has taken the risk to what they did wrong. I think we have lost the aspect of the idea of our elders, or let's say our parents, and many of you had older parents. And then I know my father used to tell my brothers, he never told them that fishing out of season was wrong, hunting out of season was wrong. He said, the only stupid thing that you do, the only wrong thing you do is being stupid enough to get caught. So it was like his rights. The rights were there. But I like it as a positive approach of trying to teach the students that we have today, and they have more education, and they have more, maybe more resources than we had. Mm-hmm. In the lady before that was there, like we were in that age where everybody was not really recognizing our rights and all that, of trying to regain the rights that we gained with the first treaties that we had, with hunting and all the other things, that we did have more, because I knew one time that they said, okay, you had the right to get the basket material from anywhere in Nova Scotia. It didn't have to be your land. But that hasn't been mentioned for years. But I do like that approach. I'm trying to teach the students to take advantage of the resources that are available to them or will be available to them, or find different resources where they can gradually look for these treaties without anybody taking the risk. I mean, because it has this negative resource, you know, you have to do wrong, you have to do something, you have to be charged. So it was negative in that way. But I think trying to teach them to do a more positive approach, that we find something that was supposed to be ours, but it isn't anymore, and try to find resources that would recognize or have a treaty in that place that is okay. This was a right that you had as Native people. Let's not wait for until somebody has the gumption or the courage to go and see, break this rule, and then we'll deal with it. Mm-hmm. But be a more positive approach.
Chief Leroy, this is all in regarding to, I know this is, we're talking treaties here, and as I recall in my last Board of Directors meeting, I came meeting, the Chief asked, I told him all through the workshop, the conversations I had with the Minister, the Premier, and this initiative for treaty education. Again, the Chief asks regarding the inherent indigenous rights, Aboriginal title, the title of the land, the rights of our land, and you guys include Aboriginal rights, Aboriginal title, the curriculum, or just is there a difference? Mm-hmm. We're talking about just treaties, we're talking about the inherent rights, Indigenous rights, mm-hmm. and the recent Native Declaration of Indigenous rights of the people, you know, those type of things.
Right.
Is that included?
Right.
Also
yes.
The
title. Mm-hmm. Good point. We try to keep up on all the contemporary issues, contemporary treaties, the court cases, the Supreme Court rulings, all of that for the upper grade levels. And, but it's the treaties and if you want to say the spin-off effects of treaties, like the breaking the rules to get into court to have those treaty rights asserted by the courts.
Okay. I'd just like to take this time to thank our presenter this morning, Brenda Henneke. You know, it's not hard to see why the Canadian Race Relations said that this is a best practice throughout Canada, and you know, we strive to see some things similar within our community. So I'd just like to offer her a little gift on behalf of the Mi'kmaq Nation for her presentation today, and thank her.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think we've had a great discussion today. We've actually skipped over our health break and straight to lunch, which isn't a bad thing. I think that you know, what we're doing is discussing, so I wanted to give lots of room for questions and didn't want to interrupt any of that. But if you feel time, you need to take a health break or a washroom break, feel free. I'm glad that we're going to continue this discussion in the afternoon. What we've seen here is the best practices in Canada. What we're going to be talking about in the afternoon is what some of the things that we're doing within Nova Scotia right now, and some of the things moving forward on treaty education, some of the great projects are out there. And of course, later on in the day, we're going to have a little bit of a discussion on what we need, as well as a full day tomorrow. What I'm going to ask, we're going to have a lunch there. We have some health, some snacks available out there as well. But what I'm going to ask is, we realize that tomorrow there's going to be a funeral in Eskasoni. So what we'd like to do is just have a half hour lunch, and so that we can have some discussion at the end of the day for those of us who aren't going to be here tomorrow, but be able to hear from everyone on what it is that they'd like to see moving forward. I'm glad Leroy spoke about the meeting with the Minister of Education and Wyatt that we had in Halifax that created the commitment for treaty education. We hope that we can build on that. We know that this is a starting point for the discussion, and that the chiefs have also authorized further discussion in April amongst the leadership to get the ball rolling. So this is all about getting the ball rolling and continuing on that and to see where we can end up. But with that, I'm going to say, you know, let's have a lunch, health break, and resume in 30 minutes if we can. Thank you very much for a good morning.